ज्ञानति मिरन्दस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदा मह्यं ददाति सुपदान्तिकम् वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरु श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं सागरजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवम् श्रीराधा कृष्णपादांसगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च नमो विष्णुपदाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादि पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे नमो महावदन्याय कृष्णप्रेमप्रदाय ते कृष्णाय कृष्णचैतन्यनामिने गौरद्विषे नमः हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वांछाकल्पतरूप्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्येव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौरभक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे सो हरे कृष्णा सो एज यूजुअल वील कमेंस विद यमुनाचार्य समरी वर्स इन गीतार्थ संग्रह फॉर द 14th चैप्टर एंड देन गोइंग टू द वर्सेस वी हैड ऑलरेडी डन 13 वर्सेस लास्ट टाइम सो वी विल डिस्कस फ्रॉम वर्स नंबर 14 टुडे सो बिफोर दैट वील जस्ट वंस अगेन हैव अ लुक एट यमुनाचार्य समरी वर्स गुणबंध विदा तेषां कर्तृत्वं तन्निवर्तनं गतित्रयस्वमूलत्वं चतुर्दश उदीर्यते सो ही सेज इन द 14th चैप्टर देर आर फोर टॉपिक्स फर्स्ट इज गुणबंधानुविदा द मैनर इन विच द थ्री गुणास ऑफ सत्व रजस एंड तमस कॉज बॉन्डेज इन संसार कर्तृत्वं सेकेंड टॉपिक इज द नेचर ऑफ कॉजिंग एक्शंस दैट रिसाइड्स इन दिस थ्री गुणास The third is Tannivartanam, the means to dispel these gunas. And fourth is Gatitrayasya Moolatvam. And that Bhagavan is the one who gives all three Purushartas, namely Aishwarya, Kaivalya and Bhagavat Prapti. And these are told in the 14th Adhyaya. So this is how Srila Yamunacharya summarizes the verse. So Gunanubandha Vidha, how the three gunas cause bondage in samsara are discussed in the first 18 verses. That is from 14.1 till 14.18. That is the topic. And last time, if you remember, we saw Krishna essentially says that Sattva Guna binds you to knowledge and consequently happiness. So the logic is when you know something very exactly the way it should be known, there is a happiness that arises from it. So that is how knowledge and happiness are connected. And Rajoguna binds one to action. Okay, so please remember, Rajoguna is not binding to passion or it's not binding to anything else but action. So action becomes the forefront. And Tamoguna binds one to being distracted. So these are the three important keywords which are used by Krishna in the first part of this chapter. So anyway, I'll not recap more, otherwise we'll spend a lot of time in that only. So we are going to go ahead now to the 14th verse, which is our today's theme of discussions. We had already done the first 13 verses last time. Yeah. So we had done all this. Yeah, the 13 verses was done. So now the 14th verse. So here onwards, Krishna is talking about the destinations. Right? Yada sattve pravriddhe tu pralayam yati deha vritti tadottama vidam lokan amalan pratipadyate. When the embodied jivatma meets with death, when the sattva guna is predominant in him amongst the other two gunas, then the jivatman attains next birth in the family of people who know the true nature of jivatma, who do not have a tinge of ignorance. So as usual, I wish to specially focus on those parts which are different from Prabhupada's commentary. Prabhupada in this particular verse, he talks about the fact that when one dies in the mode of goodness, he attains to pure higher planets of the great sages, like that he writes. Okay, slightly different commentary here. So what Ramanujacharya says is, Uttama Vidam Lokan. Please focus on that verse. Uttama Vita. Uttama Vita means one who understands Atma. Lokan means the family of people who know Atma. Okay. So basically the commentary that is given here is, if somebody isn't prominently Sattvaguna throughout his life, so please note, he's not even saying that yes, it's only Sattva, because that's not possible at all. Rajoguna and Tamoguna are an inevitable part of life. So that is why that word pravriddhetu, pravriddhetu means, the translation is predominantly Sattvaguna. Then he attains in the next birth. He's born in the family of those who know about Atma. That means he's born in the family of those who are yogis. That's how Srila Ramanujarya translates this verse. So he says that he's born in the family of yogis, where he can start performing karma yoga, jnana yoga, dhyana yoga, bhakti yoga, whatever. Right? So he gets that opportunity right away. So this is the long-term consequence of Sattvaguna. So till last verse, we saw the short term. That means he's happy. This one is caught up in action and the Tamoguna fellow is distracted and so on. But now we are looking at a little bit destination for each of these. Right? So this is some difference here in the commentary. So that's why we also understand that Shrestha birth. Right? So the Gita does talk about it. So that's why birth is not totally negated in the Gita. Sometimes we have this understanding, right? Based on the fourth chapter, Guna Karma Vibhagashah. We think that Guna Karma Vibhagashah, in Guna Karma, birth is not there. We generally say like that. But Guna is again connected to birth, because depending on your Guna, you are born in a particular place. Like that, right? So there is some correction. So like that. Going ahead to the 15th verse. I'm going to focus on especially one or two verses later in the sequence today, which are very, very interesting commentary. So on the others, which are pretty straightforward, I'll go quickly. So 15th verse, Rajasi pralayam gatva karmasanghi shuchayate tata pralenas tamasi mudayoni shuchayate. So he says here, when the embodied jivatma meets with death, when the rajoguna is predominant in him among the other two gunas, he attains the next birth in the family of people who are engaged in works attracted only by ordinary fruit to worldly fruits. Similarly, when the embodied jivatman meets with death, when the tamoguna is predominant in him among the other two gunas, he attains the birth in species such as dog, pig, etc., and becomes unqualified to achieve any purushartha. So very similar translations of Srila Prabhupada as well. One or two slight differences are there. One thing is, in the commentary here, Ramanujari emphasizes that it's not only about meeting with death in, because if you look at the verse, direct verse, it says Rajasi Pralayam. Pralayam basically means death. Gatva. So it seems as if at death, if you are in Rajoguna, then you are born in such family. Like that it seems to be, right? So Ramanujacharya says, no, you have to apply the same logic which was there in the previous verse. Because the previous verse had said Pravriddhe. Pravriddhe means predominantly in one's life. So he says it's not the guna at the time of death, rather it is what you were predominantly in your life that decides where you go. So that is the kind of commentary he gives. Which is kind of making sense, right? Because for example, some devotee sometimes passes away in sleep. Now sleep is tamoguna. Just because he passed away in sleep, you cannot say that, at death he was in. So sleep is tamoguna. I mean, anyone, sleep is tamoguna only. Right? So if he passes away in sleep or an unconscious state, you cannot say that just because at that death, that tamoguna was perhaps slightly higher in terms of his consciousness at that time, he will be born in the lower species. We cannot say that, because predominantly in his life, he was in sattvaguna only. So that's the argument that he gives. And also he quotes the previous verse. In the previous verse, that word pravriddhe is there. That's why here he has put the word pravriddhe in bracket. He says that in the previous verse, that word pravriddhe, which was there, is applicable to these verses also. Like that he says. So he says that predominantly throughout your life, if Rajoguna was there, when that person meets death, he is born in a family which is attracted in various actions. That means they're very, very active due to Rajoguna. They are engaged in various actions for fruitive results. And Tamoguna, of course, he's born in the lower species. So that is the commentary here. Yeah. So now at this point, so what is so till now it has been told where he is born. Now what he achieves is being further illustrated here in the 16th verse, which is summarizing for all three gunas. Karmana Supratasya hu sattvikam nirmalam phalam rajasastu phalam dukkham ajnanam tamasa phalam. Work performed as a form of worship of Bhagavan with no interest in its ordinary fruits. By one who died with elevated Sattva-guna and thus is born in the family of Atma-jnanis, leads to further increase in Sattva-guna and results in happiness unalloyed with even a tinge of sorrow. Rajoguna that was elevated in a person at the time of death leads to more and more rajasic nature and thus causes the person to revolve around in samsara full of sorrows. Tamoguna that was elevated in a person at the time of death results in increased state of ignorance. Thus, these are stated by great men who know the paths of development of Sattva, Raja, and Tamoguna. So here, what is being said is, okay, he has taken birth. After he takes birth in such a place, what does he achieve? Okay, so the Sattva Guna person is born in a family which is of predominantly yogis, etc. Rajoguna in the form of in the family where fruitive action is predominant, and Tamoguna in Ajnana. So here only three words are important. Sattvikam, so those who are in Sattva-guna, who are born in such families, what will they do automatically? Sukritasya karmanah. Sukritasya karmanah, Ramanuja says, is nothing but he engages in Nishkama Karma Yoga. So that's the translation actually. He is serving Bhagavan with no interest in the fruits like that. He achieves Nirmalatvat. So that one word is very important. Nirmalatvat. Nirmala means what? So Nirmala, Ramanuja says, is Dukkha Gandha Rahitam is Nirmala. Dukkha Gandha Rahitam means, he says, there is no smell of Dukkha only. That is Nirmalatva. Okay, so if somebody wants to be happy, the secret of being happy in this world is Sattva-guna. Because if somebody is Sattva-guna, then you can reach this, you can achieve this state called Nirmalatva. And Nirmala, Nirmala means no smell of dukkha. So basically he's happy. He's truly happy in Sattva-guna. Rajoguna, what happens? For Rajoguna, the ultimate destination is dukkha. Okay, he's born in the family of those who are in fruitive action. But what does he get? He obtains dukkha. And Tamoguna, what does he get? He gets ajnana. Okay, so Ramanujacharya says that somebody may say, "Are, for Rajoguna, why are you saying Dukkha? Why don't we say for Tamoguna it is Dukkha?" He says, "No." He says, "Because the Tamoguna living entity doesn't even understand that he is in Dukkha. That is Tamoguna." Okay, so Tamoguna means like if the creatures who are born in lower species, etc., they don't even experience Dukkha. As in, there is dukkha, but they don't understand that there is dukkha, right? What they only they are basically in what is called as ajnana. That means complete darkness. They just don't know why all this is happening or what they are experiencing. They just don't know that. So dukkha is perceived in rajoguna only. Tamoguna it is not. Only someone else can understand that the tamoguna person is dukkhi. But the fellow in Tamoguna doesn't understand. I mean, we always give the standard example, right? Like somebody who is excessively drunk and he's lying down on the street, he doesn't understand that he's suffering. In fact, if you go and tell him that you're suffering, he'll get angry with you, right? So though we understand that looking at his state, that, oh, this is terrible. So that is ajnana. Okay, so birth was told in the previous three verses. Now a little bit more long-term state is given. Okay, the Sattva-guna person, Nirmalatvat, Rajoguna, Dukkha, and Tamoguna, Ajnana. These three words we need to always remember. Right? Now, somebody may say, how is this Nirmalatva, Dukkha, or Ajnana? What does it mean? Can we give some more? Can we try to understand how they achieve Nirmalatva? What is Nirmalatva? What is Nirmalatva? What is Dukkha? Right, so that Krishna explains in the next verse. Look at the 17th verse. Sattva sanjayate jnanam rajaso lobha evacha pramada moho tamaso bhavato jnanam evacha. Through the strong growth of sattvaguna, knowledge in the form of direct perception of the jivatman atma sakshatkar will be produced. From the strong growth of rajaguna, the excessive desire for heaven and such fruits keep growing. From the increased growth of tamaguna arises the increased inadvertence, which leads to contrary knowledge, and finally this leads to total ignorance, becoming a non-sentient entity. So let's go one by one. Sattvaguna. For sattvaguna, Krishna had said nirmalatva. So what is that nirmalatva? Here he is saying, sattvat jnanam sanjayate. He gets jnana. Now somebody may say, are in the 14th chapter beginning only we had said jnana, right? We had said sattvaguna binds you to jnana and sukha. Or Krishna had said, sattvaguna means you understand everything the way it is through your, the various senses. Why again Krishna is saying jnana? So Ramanujacharya says, this is not the same jnana that is being spoken here. This is the long-term consequence of sattvaguna. So initially, yes, when there is sattvaguna, what is going to happen? You understand things as they are. That is the jnana which was spoken in the earlier part of the 14th chapter. But now what is being said is, by prolonged sattvaguna over lifetimes, a person is going to get the jnanam of the jivatma. Okay, that means he comes to like Brahman realization. And that jnana is what is being spoken here, he says. So this jnana is not just some the jnana that was spoken in the earlier part of the 14th chapter, because that was already covered, right? We had already said that jnana is there. But this jnana is nothing but direct perception of jivatma. So that is being said here. That means literally like Atma Sakshatkar. That is what Sattvaguna is eventually going to take you. Rajoguna, what does it take you to? And that is why Nirmalatva. Because you are going to have Brahma Sukha, a person is Nirmalatva. He doesn't have even the smell of Dukkha in him. So, you know, all these verses are connected to the previous verse. So remember from where we started today. We started by talking about destinations. We said the sattvaguna person takes birth in a family of yogis. As a result of that, nirmalatva. Why nirmalatva? Because he reaches Brahman Sakshatkar. Similarly, the rajoguna person, he takes birth in a family of those engaged in fruitive action. Okay, dukkha. Why dukkha? Because of lobha. So lobha is the cause of dukkha. So that is the connection. So in the previous verse, it was said, right, rajoguna's long-term effect is going to be dukkha. Okay, so now here it is being said, why? Because of excessive desire for various things. So lobha is a, you know, greed, we understand, right? So excessive desire for all objects. That excessive desire causes the burning in a person, and that causes dukkha. And tamoguna, what was the consequence? Ajnana. Why ajnana? Because of contrary knowledge and pramada. Pramada, we have already discussed this before. Pramada basically is distraction, lack of awareness, contrary knowledge, and finally complete darkness. That leads to complete darkness. So that is how Krishna has spoken. Right. Next is the very, very long term. So where a person goes in terms of birth, in where is he born? Right? Not in terms of families, but in terms of location. Krishna is saying in the 18th verse, very famous verse, Urdvam gacchanti sattvastha madhye tishtanti rajasa jaganya guna vrittistha adho gacchanti tamasaha. The translation here is again very similar to that of Srila Prabhupada. So I'll go over it a bit quickly. The later verses are having much more discussion. So we'll spend more time with that. So here it says, those who are steadfast in sattvaguna keep rising to higher levels in subsequent urdham gacchati. Those who abide in rajaguna enjoy the results in heaven, etc., and get reborn and again just loitering up and down in samsara. Those who abide in tamoguna keep performing tamasic actions of the lowest quality and will progressively be borner in lower states. A very similar commentary and translation. Only thing Ramanujacharya says is that yaksha, gandharva, human being, these are all madhye. Intermediate planetary systems. Urdhvam is also referring to the higher planetary systems like above Swargaloka, Maharloka, Janaloka, Tapaloka, etc. Below that is all the Bhubhuvasvaha is all for Rajoguna. And the other yonis which are there, We are all for the Tamoguna. Right, so yeah. So till now, the first topic of Yamunacharya is completed. Yamunacharya, remember, he said there are four topics in the 14th chapter. The first topic is Guna Bandha Vidha. That means, how do the gunas bind you? That Krishna has completed here. Right? And just a 1 minute recap. Sattvaguna binds us to knowledge and happiness. Rajoguna to action. Tamoguna to inattention. And how are these gunas born in us? This is all we had done in the last class. By our previous birth and also by what we eat. So these are two things through which gunas develop in our body. Then in today's class, we saw about several verses that spoke about long-term consequences. Sattvaguna, one is born in families of those who are engaged in yoga. Rajoguna, those in action. Tamoguna, in lower species or Mooda Janma, like that. Then Sattvaguna leads to Nirmalatvat, Rajoguna leads to Dukkha, and Tamoguna leads to Ajnana. Why Nirmalatvat? Because there is Jnana, Brahman realization in Sattvaguna. Rajoguna, why Dukkha? Because of Lobha. And Tamoguna, why Ajnana? Because of complete distraction and contrary knowledge being developed. Yeah, so this is how one is bound. Right? Now Krishna is saying who is actually the doer. This is the second topic, Kartrutva. The second topic of Yamunacharya, which Yamunacharya says four topics. The second topic is in 19th and 20th verse. We'll have a look at it. Nanyam gudevya kartaram yada drishthanu pasyati gunevyascha param veti madbhavam sodhi gacchati. When a person perceives that the jivatman who is different from the three gunas of prakriti is not the agent of action. Rather, it is only the three gunas which force the jivatma to undertake action as per their inherent qualities, and realizes that the jivatma has been different from the three gunas as the non-doer of action. Such a person attains a state similar to my nature. Okay, so this verse requires explanation. So this verse, Krishna is basically saying, who is the doer? So who is the doer? Krishna is saying it is actually the modes who are the doer. The Jivatma, he is not the doer. Rather, it is the modes which make a person do something. And Krishna says, when one realizes that, then one actually adhigachati. He attains a state similar to Krishna. He attains a state similar to Krishna means what? He basically transcends. Right? He transcends and he attains the bhava of the Lord. So here a question can be raised that in the previous verses, we saw Krishna saying that Sattvaguna leads to Jnanam, which is like Brahmajnana, etc. And now here he is saying that only when you literally kind of go beyond the three modes, you know, that's the topic that's going to come from now onwards. Understanding that you are not even, it's not you. But it is a Sattvaguna which is making you do, etc. That means only when you... So the point is, till previously Krishna was talking as if Sattvaguna would lead you to higher destinations. Now Krishna is saying only when you understand that you are not the doer at all and you go beyond the three modes in the sense. Go beyond the three as in you understand that you are not the doer, the three modes are doing. Then only. So how do you reconcile the two? Okay, so he says... there is no confusion. The point is that initially what Krishna said is, it's connected. So it is only because of being in Sattvaguna that this knowledge can come. That means only the person who is consistently in Sattvaguna, for him this knowledge will arise in him that I am not the doer. If one is not in Sattvaguna, that knowledge only will not arise in him. He will keep thinking that I am the doer. So this state which Krishna is speaking in this verse is technically called Akritva Anusandhana. Akritva Anusandhana means I don't do anything. It is the modes under the direction of the Lord, the Prakriti, which is doing various things. I am only a witness sitting in my body. This understanding who can get? This understanding only the person in Sattva can get. In Rajoguna, Tamoguna, because in Rajoguna you are caught up in action. So you are not so contemplative to think about all this. And Tamoguna, of course, there is darkness, there is mudatvam and so on. So only Sattva Guna allows a person to come to this understanding. It's not a theoretical understanding. It's a very deep understanding to have that I'm not doing anything. The various modes in my body, as and when they arise, they make me do various things. Right? When there is a need for me to hungry, I'm moving around, collecting things, cooking and eating. When I'm thirsty, I go around, take water and I drink. I'm doing action. When I feel sleepy due to tamoguna, I fall asleep at night. And due to sattvaguna, I start understanding things correctly the way they are. So that means the person understands that it is the modes in my body which are doing everything. I am only witnessing. And this knowledge can come only to a person in sattvaguna. So that is how being in sattvaguna is the first step. And the second step is going beyond that sattvaguna by understanding that you are not these three gunas like that. All right, so that is how this commentary is given. So this is the connection of sattva guna and a person going beyond the three gunas like that, right? So that is what Krishna is saying here. Ahead, guna netan ditya trin de dehi deha samudbhavan janma mrityu jara dukhair vimukto amritam. The embodied Jivatma transcends the three gunas, which are inherent in Prakriti, which has transformed into the body, thereby gets released from birth, old age, disease, and death, and attains and experiences the Jivatma in its pure state, who is full of knowledge and bliss. So here again, Krishna is talking about transcending. Gunani etan atitya tri. That means going beyond. Right? So this is connected to the previous one. Previous verse. So how are you going to transcend? Only when you come first of all to that understanding. Then you will transcend. And when you transcend, then what happens as a consequence of transcending? One is released from janma, mrityu, jara, dukkha, etc. And attains the state of atma. So kaivalya, mukti kind of state. One can attain that. Right? So one attains mukti. And that characteristic of mukti has been said here. So this is the second topic of this chapter as per Yamunacharya. So remember, the first topic was Gunanubandha, how the gunas are binding. Second topic was Kartrutva, who is the doer? The modes are the doer, I am not the doer. And understanding that helps one transcend. Now the third topic. The third topic is how to transcend the modes. Okay? And that begins with Arjuna's question in the 21st verse. Let's look at it. Arjuna vacha kairlingai strin gunane tanatiko bhavati prabho kimachara katam chaitans strin gunan ativartate. Arjuna inquires, O Lord of all, Bhagavan Vasudeva, what are the internal characteristics of a person who has gone beyond the three gunas? How will be his behavior and what are the means by which one can transcend these three gunas? Actually, Arjuna is asking three questions. Question one is the internal characteristics of a person who has gone beyond three gunas. And that answer is terrific. We will spend some time on that. Okay, so we are now talking about the transcendental personality. I mean, we use this word very, very frequently in our vocabulary, right? Among devotees, we always say it's transcendental. So what is this transcendental reality? Who is, what are the internal characters? Arjuna is asking this question to understand for himself. Okay, so this is to check for oneself whether I am transcendental or not. The second question is how will be his behavior? That is external. That word also is very, very important. Achara. This acharatina, this word acharam, achara, achar. This is very, very frequently used in Brahminical culture. Achar and prachar, right? So we say prachar is a preaching, achar is one's behavior. So this word achar, acharam, in Tamil we actually call it acharam, Sanskrit it is achara, behavior, external behavior. And the third question is, how can one transcend the three gunas? Now it's very interesting, Arjuna has asked this question because Krishna has already said how to transcend the three gunas. Didn't Krishna say just before how to transcend? Krishna said you have to be in sattva guna, and by being in sattva guna consistently over lifetimes, one understands that I am not the doer, the modes are the doer, and by reflecting on that truth repeatedly, one transcends. Krishna had already given this answer. But still, Arjuna is asking, Because Arjuna feels that this process of transcending the three gunas by being in Satva Guna consistently for several lifetimes and developing that internal knowledge is a very, very long process. I want something more quicker, he's asking. So that is the commentary here. That commentary is very interesting because Krishna is going to answer something related to that. Now let's look at the answers. Okay, so the first question Krishna is answering is internal characteristics of someone who has transcended. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Prakasham cha Pravrittim cha Mohan Eva cha Pandava Nadvesti Sampravrittani Nanivrittani Kakshati. Bhagavan Sri Krishna replies, hey Arjuna, such a person does not hate when undesirable things happen in the form of proper knowledge, illumination, which are effects of Sattvaguna, or actions which are effects of Rajoguna, or contrary knowledge which are effects of Tamoguna, nor does he long for the same to happen when desirable events in the form of knowledge, action, or contrary knowledge become withdrawn or unavailable. Okay, so this we will spend a lot of time here. The commentary is extremely interesting. This is, you know, generally, whenever we hear this term, Sattvaguna, or whenever we hear that somebody has transcended the three gunas, we imagine that such a person in his life, there is no Sattvaguna, Rajoguna, Tamoguna. That's what we generally tend to imagine. Transcendental means he's not exhibiting any action related to Sattvagun, Rajogun, Tamogun. But that is not the answer. Krishna is not saying that the transcendental person means he is not doing anything that is an outcome of Sattvagun, Rajogun. Please try to understand what is the outcome of Sattvaguna? Prakasham. Krishna is saying that word, right? Prakasham means what? Correct type of knowledge. What is the outcome of Tamoguna? Pravritti. That means you are engaged in action. And what is the consequence of being in Tamoguna? Moha. Illusion, knowledge being covered, etc. Okay. So, the person who is transcended, it is not that he is not going to exhibit these three. Prakasham, Pravrittim and Moha. He is going to exhibit all these. He is going to sleep. He is going to do actions of Rajoguna. Whatever they may be. He's going to understand things as per Sattvaguna. Because as long as you are in this body and in this material world, the three gunas are unavoidable. Even if you want to walk on the street, you need Rajoguna for that. Without that, you cannot even walk because walking is action. That action needs Rajoguna. You want to sleep at night, you need Tamoguna. Right? So three gunas are unavoidable. So then what do you mean by saying that someone has transcended? Now look at Krishna's answer. So the point is, there are two things here. One is, this knowledge, action and moha, these three things can happen in two circumstances. One is undesirable and one is desirable. What do you mean undesirable? Undesirable means sometimes we get knowledge which is undesirable. Undesirable, I'll explain, give an example. The commentary gives an example here. That means, let us say, like sometimes we say also, right? Ignorance is bliss. If I didn't know something, I'm happy. When I know something, it actually becomes a problem. Because you know something exactly, then it is even more difficult to handle. Okay, so the commentary gives a simple example. It says that let us say a man is standing somewhere and at a far distance there is a rope, something that looks like a rope. But because he has Sattvaguna, I mean that's an example here, his knowledge is perfect. So he immediately understands that that is not a rope, that is a snake actually. But when he understands that it is a snake, though it is far away from him, he actually feels, oh my God. You know, so that means that knowledge only it is, correct knowledge he got that it is a snake. But it was an undesirable event, right? But the undesirable event, the correct knowledge of the undesirable event came up in his life. Correct? So, he does not hate it. That's what he said. That means, the person transcendental means he will get knowledge of undesirable events, but he does not hate it. He does not feel, array, why did I come to know this? It would have been better had I not known this only. You know, andhagar mein jeeta tha main, achhi tarah se. Right? So, one person feels like that. Similarly, due to rajoguna. Okay, so let's say he ate something improper. Many times it will happen that. So that is the example given in the commentary that somebody may eat something which is improper food. So that is an action that was done, eating. And it was an action, undesirable action. You ate something which was improper. But he doesn't hate it too much. He doesn't self-pity himself too much, saying that, "Arey Baba, I ate it. Why did I do that?" Like that. Okay. Or sometimes he may. So this is the point, right? So I hope you're getting this. This prakasham, pravrittim, and moham can happen in undesirable situation, and it can happen in desirable also. Desirable means I want to get something nice, right? Like I went to a temple and I know that in this temple I get the best sakra pongal, the best sweet. Okay. So he has that knowledge. He knows that in this temple, the sweet that is offered as prasad is the best in town. But he doesn't hanker for it, as in he doesn't feel that I must get it. No, mila to mila, nahi mila to nahi mila. That kind of a thing. Right. Then similarly, tamoguna also. So he gives an example. Sleep is needed. But let us say one day he's unable to sleep for some reason. He's not getting proper sleep at night. Then he's not overly disturbed as a result of that. Okay. So this is how the commentary is. That means person who is transcended doesn't mean he is not doing the actions related to sattvagun, rajagun, tamogun. But he is not hankering or lamenting for the desirable or undesirable effects of sattvagun, rajagun, tamogun in his life. So please think about it. It's a very, very deep point. Right? So that means in our life, there are sattvagun, rajagun, tamogun is always going to be active. We are going to do various things. Some will be desirable, some will be undesirable, which we may be forced to do, or we may land up in that situation. Neither he hates it, nor he is very anxious to obtain it. He just allows his body to go in that particular direction. So I was just thinking, you know, this is the qualification for someone to do something extraordinary also. Like, for example, we see that Lord Shiva drinks poison. He has snakes around his body. These actions are actions of tamoguna only. But Lord Shiva neither despises it, nor he looks forward to it. So he is transcendental. Though the action is the action of tamoguna, the person's consciousness is transcendental. That is what this verse is saying. So transcendental doesn't mean in the world he is not going to do anything related to sattvagun, rajagun. That he will do only. But his consciousness is beyond that. He is not hankering or lamenting for this. Okay. So I mean, going back even the other example, sometimes people ask, right, how come in our Sanatana Dharma, in Mahabharata, for example, we see Vyasadeva, he is called by Satyavati to impregnate Ambika Ambalika, Amba, right? Three lady. Ambika Ambalika, sorry, not Amba. So he comes and then Dhritarashtra, Pandu and all are born. So somebody may say, "Are, how come you allowed the sage to do such an act? Isn't it an act of passion?" It is an act of passion because it is sex life. It is an act of passion. But the thing is, Vyasadeva being transcendental, even though he is engaging in something which is the action of Rajoguna, he is not looking forward to it and he is not despising it. And that is his qualification to do that action. Okay, so transcendental doesn't mean that sattva, raja, tama will not be there. That will be there as long as body is there. But the consciousness is such that one is neither hankering nor lamenting for it. One just does it as a matter of fact. The dunya mein hai, humko ye sab karna padta hai. So he does. That is his thought process. So this is the commentary here. It is a very, very important commentary. So I just spent some time on that. Prabhupada's translation is also very, very similar to this. So, yeah, 23rd. Now, the same commentary is elaborated next verse. Udasina vadasino gunair yo na vichalyate gunavartante ityevam yovatishtati nengate. The person who is satisfied with the vision of the Jivatma, and thus he remains indifferent about all matters except the Jivatma, and hence he has neither like nor dislike towards them. Thus, he remains unaffected by the working of three gunas. The gunas are doing their allotted functions and they have no relevance to myself. Thinking in this manner, he remains quiet and thus he does not come under their influence and remains steadfast in experiencing the jivatma. What a verse, and right? Amazing verse. So how is it possible? How such a person can be like this? What was said in previous verse? Krishna is elaborating. The most important word is udasina. He's indifferent. Indifferent means what? He has understood the Atma and is completely satisfied, but he knows that the body and mind which we have in this world is composed of three gunas. So that is why we have to engage in those three gunas. Okay. He is going to engage. The gunas have to do their job, but it has nothing to do with me. Thinking like that, he remains independent. See, it's an amazing state. That means transcendental doesn't mean not engaging in the three gunas. He is engaging in the three gunas. But he is, the mood is, it is the body which is engaging in these gunas. I am not doing it. I am happy in the Atma. But because I am in this body, and this body is, and the mind is having these three gunas, I will have to keep doing all these things time and again. Right? So he keeps doing. So he goes to sleep at night with his tamoguna. In the daytime, so many actions are there. And I mean actions, including the action like what Vyasadeva did, something like that. And Sattvaguna is of course there only. So he will keep doing all this. But always he knows that I am not these three gunas. And that is why he is considered transcendental. So transcendental, remember, Krishna is defining transcendental as a state of consciousness, not at the state of the bodily level. At the body level, all three gunas are going to be there only. But it is this consciousness. So if you see in this verse also, Krishna is saying the same thing, right? Three modes are doing everything. I am different from them. Okay. I am not sleeping. The body needs sleep. So that is why I need to go to sleep. Okay. So sattva was less maybe that time. That's why I didn't understand properly. Rajoguna was less. That's why I didn't get into action. He doesn't lament. See, that is another important point for characteristic to be called as transcendent. Doesn't lament means when he comes to know, for example, that array, I should have done action at that time. No, he feels that, oh, maybe that time the Rajoguna was not enough because of which I didn't do the action at the right time. No problem. Or if he didn't understand anything properly, he feels maybe Sattvaguna wasn't enough at that particular point of time. That's why I didn't understand it perfectly. So like that he feels, right? So this is the characteristic of a transcendental person. So we use this word transcendental very often. But this is the characteristic. Okay, let's go ahead now. 25th verse. Now, see, Arjuna had asked three questions, if you recall. First question of Arjuna was, what are the internal characteristics of a transcendental person? Second is, what are his behavior, achara, external characteristics? And third is, how do you transcend? So, till now, we are discussing the first question only. What are internal characteristics? And in this verse also, 3/4 of the 24th verse is also about the internal characteristics. Okay. Let's have a look at it. Samadukka sukaswastha samaroshtashma kanchanaha tulya priya priyo dhiras tulya nindatma santush sanstutihi. One who remains unperturbed in the face of joyous or sorrowful events, and his mind is steadfast in experiencing jivatma. He who treats a piece of clay, a stone, and a piece of gold as equals, as all of these are insignificant. He who treats equally all worldly objects which are either desired or undesired. He is proficient in discriminating the jivatma from the body, and one who is unaffected by praises and insults by as they pertain to the body. Okay, so further characteristics are spoken. So if you see some of these characteristics, they will remind us of the 6th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Correct? Because in the 6th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, 5th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna had spoken these points actually. Right? Krishna had said, Samadukha, Samaloshtrashma Kanchanaha, that phrase has come as it is here. That equanimity, how much Krishna has emphasized on it. That's why these chapters are considered an appendix to the first part of the Gita. You remember when I started 13th chapter itself, I said, Ramanacharya, Yamanacharya, both of them say that 13 to 18 chapter Krishna is not teaching anything. What is taught before, it's like an appendix. He's adding something. Right? He's elaborating some point. Okay, so internal characteristics are what? He's not disturbed much and he treats things equally, tulya priya priya, right? Favorable, unfavorable situation, so on and so forth. The last part of the verse, if you see, that is external behavior. Why that is external behavior? Tulya ninda atma sanskriti. That means praise and insult, because that is external. Praise and insult are external, right? And not to be affected by that. So that these are external things are now coming. And the next verse is again fully about external things only. What is said in the 25th verse? Mana pamana yostulyas tulyo mitrari pakshayoho sarvaranambha parityagi gunati tasa uchyate. He does not get affected in any manner because of honor and dishonor. See, these are external things, honor, dishonor. And thus who treats friends and enemies, who praise him or who insult him equally. He was renounced all actions to secure anything else other than the realization of Jivatma. Such a person is said to have transcended the three gunas. These are again external things, right? Not to be affected, treating people equally. These are all external. So this is the second question of Arjuna. What is his acharan? What is the behavior? And the sarvarambha parityagina, what it means is, it see, at one level, it means that he has renounced actions other than realization of Jivatma. But then, what do you mean by saying that he has renounced all actions? He has renounced all actions means he doesn't think I'm doing anything. He thinks that the modes are only doing, so that he doesn't count as his action. He thinks that my only action is how to progress in spirituality. That is my own action as the Jivatma. Everything else is as per the modes, because there is Rajoguna, I have to do something. So the body has to do something, it is doing. I am not doing that. Okay, the only thing I am doing is progressing in spirituality. So this is how he is feeling. So that is how this particular phrase is defined. Sarvarambha parityag. Sarvarambha parityagi means he doesn't think he's doing, rather he thinks that the modes are doing, and the only thing I am doing is progressing in spiritual life, like that. And such a person is transcended the three gunas. Now, okay, we're coming to the last two verses. Now, how do you understand? Now, how to transcend? Now, see, this question of Arjuna is important. If you remember, I had told you earlier that Krishna had already answered it. Krishna had already said how to transcend by saying that if you're consistent in Sattva, you understand that over a period of time, you start understanding that actually the modes are doing, I'm not doer. And that is how you transcend, by understanding that you are not the doer, you transcend. Krishna had already said how to transcend. But Arjuna is asking means, the commentary is, Arjuna wants a more easier process to transcend rather than, you know, waiting for multiple births. So that is why Krishna is giving the quick solution to transcend. Mam chayo vyabhyavicharena bhakti yogena sevate sagunan samati tetyan brahma bhuyaya. Whichever person worships me through bhakti yoga along with its auxiliaries, which is performed only towards me with no consideration of mundane benefits, such a person crosses over the three gunas and becomes qualified to attain the state of God. So here Krishna is giving a upaya, which is more easier than the previous upaya. So please remember, upaya was already given. If you are in sattva guna consistently over lifetimes, then you will come to that understanding that I am not the doer, and then because you are not the doer, you will neither hate nor despise the action, and thus you are transcendental. Krishna had answered all that. But now he is giving another method. What is the other method? By engaging in bhakti yoga towards Krishna, right? And how is this bhakti yoga? This bhakti yoga, avyaya. Ramanujacharya focuses a lot on the avyaya. Avyaya means only Krishna. That means focused on Krishna when bhakti yoga is done. And why does it give benefit? He says Krishna has three characteristics. One is satya sankalpa. He can drive all your sinful reactions. He's ashrita vatsala. He gives shelter to anybody who desires. And he has apara karuna, infinite compassion. Because of these three qualities of Sri Krishna, he will help us cross the three gunas. So this is another method of crossing the three gunas, which is a more easier upaya. Other than the other one that Krishna had already said. Okay. And when you cross the three gunas, what happens? Brahma bhuyaya kalpate. Brahma bhuyaya kalpate means what? One attains the state of Brahman. At this point, somebody may say, "Are only Brahman I will attain? by crossing over the three gunas, what about becoming a devotee? That is why the last verse of this chapter. Now, this last verse, Ramanujacharya's translation is completely different than what Prabhupada translates or what many other commentators have done. And this is connected to the last theme of Yamunacharya. Remember, Yamunacharya had said four topics in the 14th chapter. The first was how the modes bind. Second was who is the doer. Third was how to transcend, which is all done now. And the fourth is how Krishna is Gatatrayasya Mulatvam. That means he is the one who gives all the three gatis. And that is the translation he gives for, Ramanuja gives for the 27th verse. It's a little different, the translation. So please pay attention. Brahmanohi pratishtaham amritasya abhyaveyasya cha shashvatasya cha dharmasya sukasya ikantikasya cha. The reason why I only bestow the Kaivalya Moksham is attaining the nature of pure Jivatma, who is imperishable and full of bliss, and he who is without contraction of knowledge in his pure state, and attaining the wealth for a long time, and experiencing the absolute Brahman, Sriman Narayan, attaining bliss, all these fruits are granted by me alone. Some explanation is needed here. So in the previous verse, Krishna had said, right, that if somebody engages in bhakti to me, then he transcends and he becomes Brahma Bhuyaya Kalpate. Brahma Bhuyaya Kalpate is like Kaivalya Bhakti. So then somebody may think, how is Krishna giving Kaivalya Mukti? If that question comes in your mind, Krishna is answering. What is he answering? That all the three things he only gives. What are these three things? One is Kaivalya, other is Aishwarya, wealth, and the third is Bhagavan himself, the spiritual world. Correct. So this is the continuous commentary which Ramanujacharya has maintained from the seventh chapter, if you recall. Right, from the seventh chapter, he has maintained this commentary only. That three things the Lord gives is Kaivalya, Aishwarya, and Bhagavan Labha. That means Bhagavan himself, the spiritual world. So, how we have seen this translation is the first part of this translation, Brahmana Amritasya Abhyavasya. This is relating to Kaivalya Mukti. Okay, Shashvatasya Dharma Dharmasya. Shashvata means, here it means wealth, and dharmasya means wealth obtained by the best possible dharma. And what is that dharma? By approaching Bhagavan. Okay, so this is all connected to the 7th chapter, 7.15. Krishna had said that artho jignasur artharthi jnani. Artharthi, all those people are there, right? Those who approach Krishna for opulence. They get opulence which is shashvatasya. Now, what is shashvatasya? How can wealth be shashvat? So here, the commentary, he says, shashvatasya means for a very long time he will get wealth. That means he will get wealth more than any other person who could ever imagine. And if you recall, in those verses I had spoken from Bharat Bhagavatamrita of Sanatana Goswami, where he talks about how all the coverings of the universe are full of so many opulences. And there, the devotees who reach those abodes, those opulences are higher than Indra and Brahma. And they stay there for an infinite period of time, literally. Of course, it will come to an end at some point of time. But still, it is Shashvatasya, as in it is like we say Chiranjeevi. Chiranjeevi doesn't mean literally never dies. It means a phenomenally long life, like that. So Shashvatasya Dharmasya means wealth which is obtained for a very long time. And Aikantikasya Sukhasya. Aikantiki means by focusing on that one and only Lord. Who is that one and only Lord? Lord Narayana or Krishna. By focusing on him, you get a sukha, which is the Bhagavan Labharti, the third category, the devotee. So all these things Krishna is saying, I only give. So that is how Ramanujacharya and Abhinacharya have translated this verse, which is very different from all the other traditions. And this way the 14th chapter comes to an end, and we will continue next time with the 15th chapter. Thank you very much. Any question or comment? Anybody?
Ruji, may I ask?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so 3-4 questions on this, Ruji. Like, we are currently seeing that a lot of Hindus are getting, brutally treated. And people are doing all kinds of these Islamists are doing all kinds of things. So in such situations, how can you know how does a sadhu would see such situations, who is actually seeing all this through the modes of material nature? And you know, it is very difficult to be seeing Atman at that time and thinking that all this is being done by the modes of material nature. And you know, we need to do whatever is required as per the modes and be aloof completely. I mean, even Pandavas could not have done that when their kids were killed, or you know, whatever the situation may be in the war. So how do you see this?
Philosophically, obviously, this is all a result of modes only, right? There are religious systems in the world which are tamasic. So it's like brutal tamoguna. Correct? So we know from the Puranas also, when tamoguna becomes extremely strong, it may overpower the sattva guna also. Like, for example, the Devas and the Asuras, if you see their fight. When the Asuras' power increases, their tamoguna increases, then they apparently destroy also. You know, temporarily they get the upper hand, but these are cycles. So, so that is one thing good. I mean, philosophically, I'm talking now. So, doesn't mean that one doesn't do anything. See, you know, that's a completely different question. Today, now from Gita perspective, we are seeing philosophically. Philosophically, the point is that the modes keep changing in the world, and depending on which mode is active, those type of results are seen. So when tamasa is going to overwhelm, there is a lot of destruction and there is a lot of violence, etc. And because there is a lot of tamoguna, time to time such things keep coming. But the nature of the world is that the gunas keep changing also. So with time, that also changes. So from a philosophical perspective, there is nothing to worry in that sense. But from an action perspective, yes. So as long as one is there, one has to understand, okay, so just it's just like, though I want to be transcendental, right now at night I have to sleep. I have to invoke the tamoguna, na? Only then I can sleep. So similarly, according to the need in the society, the rishis have taught us to you know, use the various gunas in order to deal with situations in the world. Right? Like otherwise, why will Vyasadeva, for example, do things which are act of rajoguna? He does it because he understands that that is beneficial for society. So he himself has no attachment to being in Rajoguna, or he's looking forward to meet those queens. Correct? But he understands that that is needed like that.
Okay, and how does, I mean, you know, how does a sadhu would see these situations sitting in, I mean, his meditative position? Somebody comes and tries to kill him, so how does he see that?
I mean, we have all these stories in our Shastras and Puranas also, where, see, there are two, three different types of responses. One response is somebody was so transcendentally situated, he never did anything. The Lord took care of him, like Prahlad and others. I mean, but that doesn't give you and me any lesson in terms of that, because most of us, perhaps, we are not at that elevated state of samadhi that they are completely unaware of what is happening. So I think we don't have to bother so much about that perspective of a sadhu, because that's going to be very, very less, as in someone who's really, you know, so spiritually advanced, who's sitting in deep contemplation of Radha Krishna pastimes.
Yeah, correct.
And
And
if a person is there like that, we see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's case, he did do some action. It's not that he just tolerated. He did a protocol.
And so how does Lord see such situations, Proji? For example, you know, he is mostly unrelated to what is happening in the material world, because ultimately there are three modes. So if some person requests him to help, so how does he see that situation?
Avatar, which is their Lord's coming direct interference, is going to be very, very less in the world. See, by and large, he has given the, what shall I say, rules for what to do. And we have to abide by that. I mean, we have to fight according to that. We cannot expect that he will actively intervene. No, Yeah, that he will intervene whenever his avatar is due. Till then, he's not going to actively intervene like that. So, see, that is the principle of the material world. Huh? He sets up the systems and he leaves. And when it becomes unbearable, he will come. But till then, he's not going to. So again, we cannot rely on that. I mean, that point is beyond our scope of what should I say.
Okay. Last thing, that this 14.27 is considered to be a very strong point against Mayavad, because directly Krishna says that Brahmano hi pratishtha, I am the basis, very basis of Brahman. And Ramanujacharya does not even touch a word, in that direction.
No, he doesn't, because see, pratishtha means you can look at those words in many ways. One is basis, and one is I am the person who gives. So he says, so in the Amarajas translation also, Lord only is the superior to Brahman, because it's very clear. He says that as the Lord, I only give these three things. Kaivalya
Correct.
also I only give, Aishwarya also I only give, and spiritual world also I only give. That is his translation. Which in one sense covers that also.
Okay, thank you.
Hare Bhagavan. Anybody else? Any question?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Hare Bhagavan.
Prabhuji, like if somebody is born in a devotee family, so they already have an advantage of having the gunas of the family who are already following the path. But we've seen cases where you are born in a devotee family and later you don't follow it once you grow up, and or you were born in a family with who are in tamo guna, but later you become pious. And in marriage cases also, we've seen girl coming in a family who are already like devotees. So how do we see the downfall when you already get an advantage of being born in a family who's already following the dharma?
Actually, what I feel sometimes, no, the word devotee family we use, it's many times our devotion is also pretty shallow. As in, we assume that we are devotees, so somebody born in our family should take to certain things. So, but many times it's more than being a devotee, it's someone who has himself started the path.
Yes.
Also the concepts of sattva gun, rajo gun, tamo guna, these are over several lifetimes they are imbibed in a person.
Yes, Prabhuji. So I meant like if you're being getting blessed to be born in a very good family or following dharma religiously, that means you definitely had some good karma from your past life. But as there was a point also mentioned in the group that when we force children a lot and sometimes they get rebellious on following the practices. So I wanted to read, is that like a mistake we make that keeps them like that takes them away from devotion and then maybe later they'll realize.
Points here. My first point is that what Krishna says is indeed true only. That means one who has a lot of sattva guna is born in family in which the acts of sattva guna are very deeply embedded in their family culture, ideas, thoughts, etc. And rajoguna action and tamoguna, this thing. Now see, what happens is what we call as devotee, na, in our society language, this sometimes tends to be a very new state of devotion only. As in, it's not so deeply gone. So, for example, like we, I mean, how do we quote unquote make devotees, right? Like we have some journey of self-discovery program, or some
Yes.
initial introductory program. We ask them to chant some rounds. And for a couple of years, they chant or do something that they take to certain devotional practices, certainly. But taking to certain devotional practices and having a lot of sattva guna embedded in your system, these are completely two different things, I wish to say. As in, it's going to take a lot of time. So even if a person has taken to certain devotional practices, how quickly he's going to transcend, that's a question. Correct. That depends on so many things: how he's practicing, what other things he's doing, how is his lifestyle, what is his food, what are his other habits, What are his other conditionings of the past? So all that also matters. So
Yes,
when
good.
you say, you know, that someone is born in that family does have a lot of other gunas also, you know. So at a superficial external level, a particular devotional practice has come. But that doesn't mean that, you know, sattva guna has dominated. Are you getting it?
Yes, yes, Prabhuji, I understand.
Yeah. So yes, certainly by taking to devotional life, your sattva guna will come up. In fact, you will transcend. Krishna himself says, Mam cheva vicharena bhakti yogena sevate. By surrendering into me, you can transcend the modes. Krishna says that. He read that verse. But still, we imagine this to be a bit too quick than it what happens. So that's why we get this question. Are, how come he's born in the family of devotee? Why? No. So you have to see, even though the family is of, you know, practicing devotee, I always use that word only. They are practicing some aspects of devotion in their life, but there are so many other conditionings and background and baggage they're carrying with them. So the child which is born is in actual line with those gunas only. Let's clear. It is, but then whether the child is going to be inspired for taking to bhakti processes which the parents have taken, that's a question that will have to be seen, because that will depend on many other things also. Many times it is how you present it to them, whether it is presented in a manner in which, you know, it is of interest to them also, whether it is forced, behaved with them and so on. So there are, it's a very large topic, Mataji, and there are,
yes sir,
why sometimes a child behaves in that way, but it
yes
certainly follows all the signs of Bhagavad Gita, the logic. Yeah, very good.
Yeah, thank you, thank you.
Hari Bol Prabhu. Prabhu, in this chapter, Krishna talks about three modes of material nature. And then again in the 17th chapter, he's talking, he's again characterizing certain things in three modes.
No, no, Ramanujacharya talks about 17th chapter in a completely different perspective. We'll come to that. When I come to that, I talk. We're going to come to it very quickly. 15, 16, 17, I'll do in only two sessions each. So we'll come quickly to 17, right? We'll come to that. I'll talk about
okay.
It. Yeah. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Shila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Gaur Bhakti Vriddhi Ki Jai.